What we're going to do is turn to our scripture reading for today. And our reading comes from James chapter 4, verses 5 to 10. Now, James is known for being one of the most practical books in the New Testament. It's not all this head stuff, what you should be believing and what you should be thinking about as a Christian. James is all about practicals, what you do, how you put all those doctrines and principles in place in your life. And there is a real practical component to how James talks about dealing with the evil one. So we're going to have a listen now. James chapter 4 from verse 5. It says, "Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us?" That's James talking about how God desperately desires to be near to us. That's why he's given us his Spirit. Verse 6, "But he gives us more grace. That is why Scripture says God opposes the proud but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. But humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his word. So folks, this is our fourth and final week of our sermon series called Jesus Rocks, where we've been looking at some classic rock songs and maybe trying to understand what the Bible might have to say about the themes and ideas in this music. Today is it's quite a nerve-wracking song for me that I've chosen. I'm not even going to give you the name. I'll just give you the band who sings it. It's the Rolling Stones. Seemingly every year we seem to come back to them. They've made such an impact in the world that we keep listening to their music. But the song is, it's quite a, what's the word I'm looking for? Quite a contentious song, and it caused a whole lot of problems when they first released it. But there's parts of it that the Bible really does agree with, and so it's definitely worth having a look and a listen to. So without any further ado, I'm not going to tell you what it is. I'm just going to play it.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his face. Pleased to meet you, hope you guessed my name. But what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. Stuck around St. Petersburg when I saw it was a time for a change. Killed the Tsar and his ministers. Anastasia screamed in vain. I rode a tank, held a generous rank. When the blitzkrieg raged and the bodies stank. Pleased to meet you, hope you guessed my name. Oh yeah. Pleased to meet you, hope you get my name.
Anyone know what the name of that song is? Something? Something about the devil. Yeah. It's called Sympathy for the Devil. And it's contentious because that is an outrageous claim that we should feel any sympathy for Lucifer, for Satan, for the devil, whatever it is that his name is. Now, you know, this larger-than-life band, Rolling Stones, that has lasted for so many decades, they've never been afraid of pushing the barriers. They've never been afraid of causing offense, either by the music that they've made, the songs that they've sang, or the things that they've done. Scandal has kind of followed this band all throughout their history. And it is still remarkable that they're still playing live music today. There's a great quote that someone once said is, you know, with all this climate change going on, we've got to start thinking very carefully about what kind of world we're going to leave behind to Mick Jagger and Keith Richards. Because they keep going so well. So it shouldn't really be a surprise that in their long list of songs that they've made, there's something like this song called Sympathy for the Devil. And it is from 1968, from their Beggar's Banquet album, and it has received critical acclaim. Lots of people have thought this is actually the Rolling Stones at their creative best. But whatever you want to say about them, or about their music, or even about the song, you need to realize that this song has been heard millions of times by millions of people in the world. And its words are worth unpacking because they have this potential to make an impact on so many people's lives. The song is penned from a first-person perspective. It's the devil singing to everyone else. And that's kind of where a whole lot of the contentiousness came from. Seems a bit dodgy to speak on behalf of the devil. But what does the Bible really have to say about this catchy song? What is going on in the song that we could learn about? And what is it that is so contentious about the song from the devil? So I want to start off with the starting point is to realize that for us as Christians, the number one thing we've got to accept is that the devil is actually real. I realize that it's very easy to live with this notion that the devil isn't a real person. There isn't a real force called the devil. People do bad things and there's evil in this world, but we are scared to attribute it to a person or to a being. What this song gets right is that it speaks about the very present reality of Satan in this world. It's a good song, the Rolling Stones song, Sympathy for the Devil, because it kind of holds a mirror up to us in society, making us realize that, hey, actually, there is someone behind all the evil that is in this world. And perhaps what it shines most in that mirror is that we seem to have two responses to talk about the devil or Satan. On the one hand, you get people who get so like sensational about it. They find the devil behind every bush, and there is this dangerous force that you need to be afraid of. That's not entirely helpful. But on the other end of the spectrum is the whole group of people who refuse to believe that the devil even exists. They are entirely ignorant. Sensational or ignorance, both of them are the wrong approach. The song actually gets it right. It speaks about the reality of the devil, and he's been around for a long, long, long time, and he's destroyed many a life and many people's faith. C.S. Lewis writes a fascinating book called The Screwtape Letters, where he writes in the form of a demon writing to his chief, his master. And in these letters comes out the genuine fear that these demons have for God and for Jesus. But in that letter, in those letters, the book that C.S. Lewis writes, he has this quote, and I think it sums up quite perfectly what we're talking about. C.S. Lewis says, "There are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. they themselves are equally pleased by both errors. The devil is happy when we are so terrified of him that we see him behind every bush and he causes us to live in fear. But he's equally happy when we are ignorant and pretend that he's not real and doesn't have any effect in this world. In the song, Mick Jagger sings as the devil himself, and he kind of speaks about how the devil has had his hand all throughout human history. He's been there in the European wars of religion, the Russian Revolution, World War II. He even speaks about how he was there making damn sure that Pilate washed his hand to seal Jesus' fate. The reality of the devil is he's real. Just because we don't see him face to face or hear him speaking to us doesn't mean that he's not having an effect in this world or even in our lives. Because it's easy to live unthinkingly. It's easy to live pretending like the devil isn't real. You know, we kind of joke about it. You know, we speak about, oh, I've got like an angel on my one shoulder and the devil on my other whispering into my ear. We trivialize it. I don't know if that's the right approach. Billy Graham said this, I thought it was pretty good. Billy Graham said, don't think of Satan as a harmless cartoon character with a red suit and a pitchfork. He is very clever and powerful, and his unchanging purpose is to defeat God's plans at every turn, including his plans for your life. The devil is real. Maybe we need to take a good hard look at ourselves and work out what kind of acceptance of that fact do we have in our lives? Are we sensational, terrified of the devil behind every single bush? Or do we largely live as if he isn't real? Maybe that's not helpful. The second thing we need to talk about is that the devil is real, but he is also very much a liar. You know, the song asks, the devil asks for a bit of sympathy. He asks for some understanding. He's kind of singing along the lines of, he's got a bad reputation, but he isn't actually that bad. Once again, that point actually agrees very much with what is said in Scripture. Not that we should feel sorry for the devil, not that he's got a bad reputation, but rather that that is exactly who he is. The devil is a liar and will tell us anything if it helps his way be bettered. There's a line in the song that says, what's puzzling you is the nature of my gain. The devil says, you know what, actually, as human beings, we are often confused about what it is that he is up to. We're confused. We think that he is far worse than he actually is. Almost as if he's not too bad. He hasn't done so many bad things. He's lying. Jesus says these words in John chapter 8, verse 44. He's speaking to the Pharisees who are so anti-Jesus that they won't listen to what he is saying. Notice what he says about them. He says, you belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language. For he is a liar and the father of all lies. From Jesus' perspective, the devil can't do anything but lie. You know, if you go back to the book of Genesis, to the story of the fall of Adam and Eve, you already see this liar trait coming to the fore in the serpent. Notice how he twists the words of what God said to convince Adam and Eve to fall into sin in the first place. He was willing to say anything to get their focus off God and onto that juicy fruit that lay there before him. Did God really say you mustn't eat from this fruit? Did God really say you must die? Surely you're not going to die. He's contradicting the very words of God. He is a liar. So I reckon the devil is pretty happy when we feel sorry for him, or when we don't believe that he is as real or as powerful as he is. He loves those lies that we believe because they help him accomplish his work. We need to be aware of this, that lying is his game. That's the nature of his game, is to lie. Sometimes he lies about who he is, or about how bad he is, or about how bad that sin is that we've just committed. Oh, it's only a small lie. No, it's not gossip. I'm telling other people so that they can pray for that person. Oh, that trait or that sin isn't so bad. There are other people doing worse things, so it's actually okay. Those are the lies that the devil would have us believe. But you know, secondly, the devil tells us lies about ourselves. He gets us to believe these lies that he whispers into our ear. Lies of the fact that you are not worthy of God's love. Or have you ever woken up and felt, you know, I am just like a failure. I'm not good enough. I can't seem to get this right. Everyone else has all their stuff together in their life and I'm falling apart. I must be the failure. Maybe we start to believe things like, God has no interest in me. Why would God be close to me? Look at all these things I get wrong. All of those are against what is said about God in the Bible. Those are lies that we begin to believe. And who is the father of all those lies? It is the devil himself. So it really does call for us to work out how we can live well in this world where the devil is real and his lies abound. We've got to not be puzzled by the nature of his game. We've got to realize who he is and what his intention is. It's not good. He is God's enemy, and because we are God's children, he is our enemy. He hates me. He hates you and everyone else. He wants to see this world destroyed and people in pain. He wants to see God's vision and plan not come to the fore. So don't listen to him. Don't give him any space in your life whatsoever. We should have absolutely no sympathy for the devil at all. We've got to realize that he is a liar, that he is evil, and we've got to give him no space in our life. But in our reading from James, we hear some pretty good practical principles to apply in our lives to help us deal with the very real threat that the devil is. The first thing is to hold on to a profound truth that God genuinely wants you. You are his son or his daughter. He jealously guards you as a lioness guards her cubs. Don't fall for the lies that the devil wants to whisper in your ear, that you're not good enough, or that God can't possibly love you, or that God only loves the perfect people who get everything right. In James 4 verse 5, we have this voice that he jealously longs for the spirit he has caused to dwell in us. God has given us his spirit, and that's almost like a magnet that is drawing us closer to God. God wants you. Accept that truth. Know that it is real, and kind of run after that. God will never push you away. He jealously wants you close to him. If we hold on to that, I think it will offer us a lot of power and strength to deal with all the other things that come our way in life. The second thing that James offers us is this idea of submitting ourselves to God. Submit yourself to God. I would say that if we are not intentionally submitting ourselves to God every day, the byproduct of that is we are falling in line with how Satan wants us to live. We might not be officially submitting ourselves to the work of the devil, but when we don't actively move away from him, I think we kind of fall into his trap. You know, James chapter 4 goes on to say, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Intentionally move away from him and focus instead on God. Submitting to God is submitting your life and your plans to his control and his purposes for your life. And you've got to intentionally do that. You've got to choose to place your life in God's hand. Do you know what the truth is? We all know this deep down inside, is that we don't live very well when we are in full control of our own lives. When we look after our own interests, when we push ourselves to the top of the priority list, we end up doing things that hurt ourselves or that hurt others. So, Submit yourself to God. Intentionally offer yourself to God. Offer your will to be lived in God's way every single day. Yield to His will and His purpose in your life. You know, there's a daily devotional on my phone, an app. It's the Lectio 365 app. And every day there is an audio devotion that gives time to pray and to think through some scriptures. It's very good. But every single day, the devotion ends with the same prayer. And I love this prayer because it speaks of just this, of submitting myself to God for that day, submitting my will to the will of God. And the prayer goes like this. Maybe this is something you want to pray every day. It says, Father, help me to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help me to give myself away to others, being kind to everyone I meet. And Spirit, help me to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all I do and say. Amen. It's a good prayer. Submit yourself to God. That's how we resist the devil. That's how he flees from us. In James 4, verse 8, James speaks about how we should all be drawing near to God. The verse, James 4, verse 8 says, come near to God and he will come near to you. When we make the move towards God, he closes that gap very quickly. But when we are running away from God, we are pushing him away. We are keeping him at arm's length from us. But when we turn to his loving presence, when we make the effort, the Bible promises that God will come near to us. You know, so part of getting rid of the devil's influence in your life is submitting yourself to God. The other part is intentionally putting yourself in situations where you can hear God's voice, where you can experience his goodness, where you can focus your attention on him. Coming near to God might look different for all of us, but it almost certainly involves some kind of scripture reading or devotion. It will involve some kind of prayer or silence. There is something you must do to get close to God. And this is maybe a wake-up call that we all need to check our own daily habits and routines, because it's easy to drift away from connecting with God on a daily basis. What is it that you can do in this next week to draw near to God so that he will draw near to you? Mentioned that Lectio 365 app. It's worth having a look at. It's pretty good. Lectio 365. And then lastly, James ends off his practical discussions on how we can deal with the devil by calling on all of us to humble ourselves before the Lord. Humble yourself before God and he will lift you up, is what it says in James chapter 4. There's mentioned in that passage of how we need to wash our hands and purify our hearts. It's a call to recognize the sin in our lives. It's a call for us to be humble enough to realize none of us are perfect. We make mistakes. We get it wrong time and time again. So we need to ask for forgiveness. We need to repent. That's what humbling ourselves in front of God is, saying, God, I am not worthy of just how much you love me because I am a fallen human being. But I pray for forgiveness and I pray for strength to be better. It's a humble way of life, knowing that you are not in charge. You don't call the shots. You are not the master of your own destiny. You need God. And so you humble yourself before him. You got to put God first in your life, not yourself or your own desires. I've recently been really challenged by a verse I found in John 3, verse 30. It's where John the Baptist sees Jesus coming towards him. And John the Baptist speaks to his disciples, who later go on to be Jesus' disciples. And as he sees Jesus coming, he says, you know, Jesus, he must increase, but I must decrease. John the Baptist knew that his job was to be a forerunner to Jesus, to prepare the way. And now that Jesus was there, he needed to take the attention, he needed to take the acclaim, and John the Baptist needed to decrease his influence in the world. But how's that for a good way of living your life? If every day you woke up with this intention, do you know what, Jesus, you and your influence needs to increase in my life. And me, Dylan, must decrease. More of you, Jesus, less of me. That is how I want to live. Humbled before you, O God. So the Rolling Stones have perhaps preached one of the greatest sermons in the form of one of their most contentious songs. I'm not telling you to go and listen to the song every day, but I am telling you that those words offer us some really good reminders that the devil is real. And perhaps we've been a bit too blasé about him and his influence in our life. Maybe we need to be far more connected to God so that we can steer clear of the devil. It's also a reminder that he's a liar. He is hell-bent on destroying you and your life. And so he will lie to you about you and your standing with God. He will lie to you about how bad the sins are and the things that you are doing. He'll even lie about his own power and his own desires. We can ignore what he says because he is a liar and the father of all lies. And we can resist him. We can live well when we submit ourselves to God, when we remember that God desperately and deeply wants a relationship with us. When we draw near to God, we are promised that he will draw near to us. And we can live well when we humble ourselves before God and give him control over the days we have here on earth. So may God bless you as you live with absolutely zero sympathy for the devil, our enemy. Amen?
Amen.
Should we bow our heads as we pray? So Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for the reminder today about the reality and the evil of the devil himself. We are sorry, Lord, for the times that we have ignored him or downplayed his influence in our lives to our own detriment. And we pray, Lord, that we would remember both his reality, but also his manner of doing work in our lives. That he is a liar and hell-bent on destruction. We ask, Lord, for your help as we strive to submit ourselves to you. We pray that you would be close to us as we draw near to you. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to remember to yield our will and our lives to you on a daily basis. We are thankful that you are the God who loves us and who desperately wants to be near to us. And we pray that that thought would get in the way of any lie the devil tries to tell us. Help us, Lord, to live well this life that you have given us. Because we know, Lord, that we live well when we live our lives for you. We ask for your help by your Holy Spirit. And this we pray for in the name of Jesus. Amen.